大家好。不好意思，我中文不太好，可能是我英文说你们方言。Today, I would like to update you on the greenhouse gas emission reduction journey, our strategies and our experiences. I also have lots of slides for you, but I promise you some of the slides are very short. Some of the questions that were already raised earlier are touched upon in the slides, and they were relating to Germany earlier, so later on I'll be happy to come back to them and answer them. Germany has taken...
好，所以今天我想要来跟大家分享一下德国在温室气体减排放的这一方面做了什么样的努力跟我们的经验。那其实今天在前面有很多人都有提到德国的经验，那我今天的投影片里面有很多的数字，那我到待会会回来再带大家一起看到这些数字跟德国的经验。
Germany takes a holistic approach and we are tackling the issue from all sides, government, industry, research and the people. So we already have a bit of history. And in Germany, the German government's energy concept and the decisions are based on the decisions of the Bundestag of June 6, 2011. And those decisions serve as the compass for steering the energy transition. The German energy targets are based on the recommendations of an expert commission, which also is tasked with monitoring the energy transition and publishing recommendations annually. The German energy policy continues to be guided by the three goals. Number one, energy security. Number two, affordable energy. Number three, environmentally compatible energy supplies. And that sounds very much like Taiwan. The top targets are cutting greenhouse gas emissions by 40% by 2020 over the 1990 figures, phasing out nuclear energy by 2022, and safeguarding energy security and competitiveness. And to achieve the mentioned goals, we pursue two core objectives: expand the use of renewables and boost energy efficiency.
所以德国在能源这方面是采取一个非常全面性的做法，政府、企业跟民众都会一起合作。那德国的国会其实就是相当于台湾的立法院，他们在2011年6月6日的决议，就是德国他们在作为能源转型的时候的一个重要指南。那他们其实有三个主要的目标，第一个是能源安全，第二个是要让他们的能源更可以负担，价格不要太昂贵，第三则是要确保他们的能源供给可以跟他们的环境相容并进。那其实这些目标跟台湾都相当的类似。那他们还有另外一些主要的目标，就是我们的投影片上面有写到的，在2020年以前温室气体要减量 40%， 2022年以前逐步废除核能，然后还要确保他们的能源安全以及竞争力。那要这么做的话，他们有两个主要的概念，第一个就是要确保他们可以用更多的再生能源，那第二方面就是要确保他们的能源使用上更有效率。
By pursuing the energy transition, the federal government is leading Germany towards a future with a secure, economic, and environmentally compatible energy supply. Furthermore, the aim of the German government is to deploy low-cost solutions and optimal system integration. This will put the conditions in place to ensure that energy remains affordable for the consumers and that the German economy remains competitive.
好，所以为了要追求这样子的能源转型，德国的联邦政府他们就要让他们的未来的能源是可以更安全、更经济，而且也更环保。那另外，他们也要采取比较低价、低成本的措施，然后让他们的整个能源系统可以更整合，这样子就可以让他们的能源更可以负担，然后同时德国的经济也可以保持他们的竞争力。
The German energy concept also includes strategies for the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. They are especially aimed at reducing energy consumption, improving energy efficiency, and replacing conventional technology and resources. And this is what our emissions in Germany currently look like.
好，所以他们的计划接下来就是要减少能源的消耗，然后替换传统的技术跟资源，也要改善能源的效率。所以以下就是目前德国他们的排放看起来的状况。
Actually, Germany has already succeeded in reducing its greenhouse gas emissions. Emissions have been decreasing ever since 1990. In 2014, a total of 912 million tons of CO2 were emitted, and in 2015, 902 million tons. However, last year, estimates suggest that emissions were up again, 906 million tons, which was mainly due to rising emissions in the transport sector, too much diesel transport, plus the 29th of February, an extra day, plus the rising GDP and economic output, plus 1.5 million more people as the refugees enter Germany. All in all, greenhouse gas emission is already down approximately 27% compared to 2019. But since 2009, there has been not much reduction. The target for 2020 is to reduce the emissions by 40% to 750 million tons. The way things are going at the moment, projections suggest a reduction in greenhouse gases of around 33 to 34% by 2020. To reach our 2020 40% reduction target, the German government adopted more than 100 additional measures in December 2014 in its 2020 Climate Action Program. In short, this is what needs to be done: shutting down coal and oil-fired power plants, pushing energy efficiency, installing even more renewables, implementing sustainable and innovative solutions in transport infrastructure, and pushing e-mobility.
所以事实上，德国在过去已经非常有效地降低了他们的温室气体排放。所以从这个图表上面，我们可以看到，从1990年开始哦，就已经逐步地在降低。在2014年的时候，他们的整体二氧化碳排放是9亿1200万吨。到了2015年的时候，这个数字下降到9亿200万吨。可是他们又预计在2016年的这个数字会稍微上升，又回到9亿600万吨，那这是为什么呢？主要是因为他们的交通方面碳排放有变多，然后是因为他们用了很多的柴油的交通工具。那另外也是因为2016年是闰年，所以二月多了一天啊，这个也有影响。那另外他们也有多收纳了150万来自中东的难民，那这一些难民也对他们造成一些影响。不过整体来说，从1990年到现在，他们的碳排放温室气体排放已经降低了27%。不过我们也可以看到这个图表上面，从2009年开始，这个降低的步伐有点减缓了。不过整体来说，他们还是认为，他们要在2020年之前达到降低40%的目标，要降低到7亿500万吨。那目前的情况看来，他们要达到降低33%到34%，应该是没有问题的。可是如果他们要真的达到40%的减低的话，那他们政府目前就是有采取了，从2014年的12月开始采取了100多个新的措施。但整体来说，他们要专注的部分就是要确保他们可以关闭他们所有的火力发电厂，确保他们的能源更加的有效率，要增加更多的可再生能源，然后也要确保他们不论是在交通建设、基本建设上，都可以有更多更智慧化、更绿能的措施。
Renewable energies has been an important factor in the success so far. It avoided 167 million tons of CO2 in 2015 and 143 million tons in 2014. Since the first half of 2015, renewable energy is Germany's number one source of electricity. Electricity consumption covered by renewable energies to date stands at 29%. On May 8th, Germany set a new daily record. 86.3% of the electricity needed on that day came from renewables. It was a very windy day in the north and a very sunny day in the south. Germany is definitely on track to meet its renewable electricity consumption targets, 45% in 2030 and even 80% in 2050. And German companies play an important role in this. They are among global market leaders in many fields and a source of inventions and innovations.
那么在过去他们的温室气体排放减低方面，他们的再生能源的贡献相当的大，所以在2015年他们用再生能源就帮助他们减少了1亿6750万吨的温室气体，然后在2014年则是减少了1亿4300万吨的温室气体。那么从2015年的上半年开始，他们的再生能源其实就已经成为德国能源的首要来源。那甚至在去年的5月8日， 他们还达到了一个新的目标，就是 86.3% 的能源都是来自再生能源。那也是因为刚好那一天他们德国北部风很大，然后南部又出大太阳。但整体来说，他们认为在接下来要达到2030年 45% 还有2050年 80% 的目标，其实他们都还在正确的道路上。那么这一路上德国的企业也是扮演了相当重要的角色，他们也是贡献相当的多。
This is the composition of the renewables in Germany. 42% of the renewables come from wind energy, of which 90% is offshore. Biomass is 27%, solar energy is 20%, and water is 11%. The key issues remain. How can we make renewable energy affordable for customers and for the industry? How can we increase public acceptance of renewables? And how can we produce even more renewable energy?
那么这张图上面可以看到德国再生能源的分布，可以看到大部分还是来自风能 42%， 其中有 19% 是来自离岸的这个风力发电机，生殖能 27%， 水力 11%， 太阳能 20%。 但接下来他们还是要专注在几个重点议题，那就是他们怎么样可以让再生能源可以让民众负担得起，然后要怎么样提升大众对于再生能源的认同度，还有怎么样才可以产生更多的再生能源。
The massive cost reduction in solar and wind power is one indicator of the innovative capacity in the renewable energy sector. The provisions of the German Renewable Act have enabled German companies to continuously improve processes and products. Power produced by wind at very good onshore locations in Germany already costs less than power produced by hard coal or natural gas power plants. The highest cost reductions have been achieved in PV.From 2006 to 2015, average system price fell by more than 70%. Financial assistance is provided by the Renewable Energy Act, focusing on low-cost technologies like wind and solar power. The improved funding is to encourage more private, commercial, and municipal investment in installations into renewables.
那么在过去德国政府大幅的降低了再生能源的成本，那么这一个作为也显示出再生能源这个产业他们的创新有多么的厉害。那么过去这个德国政府他们的风力发电成本已经进步到比他们的火力发电还要来得更加的便宜。那么最大的减低价格跟成本的减低是来自他们的太阳能，从2006年开始到现在，他们太阳能生产的成本已经降低了 70%。 那么此外，德国政府也有通过法案来辅助提供资金上面的补助，来补助这些比较低成本的，像是风力发电还有太阳能发电。那么接下来他们也希望可以持续的鼓励更多私人企业或者是地方政府来一起投资再生能源。
Germany has already seen about 40 years of green movements, so Germany does indeed enjoy very high approval rates for its energy policy. Last year polls shows that 93% of the people think that the future development of the renewables in Germany is either important or very important. They realize that renewables save the climate and make us independent from energy imports and from dangerous nuclear power plants.59% of the people think that renewables provide opportunities for more civic participation in local politics. And even the EEG-Umlage, which is a levy added to each kilowatt hour of electricity for private consumers in order to generate funds for the development of the renewables, enjoys a high approval rate in Germany. These extra costs have been raised to 2.4 Taiwan dollars in 2017,But still, 60% of the people say these extra costs are okay or even too low. Here in Taiwan, politicians fear nothing more than demonstrations against rising energy costs. You may ask now, why are there no demonstrations like that in Germany? In Germany, people realize that it takes money to pay for the investments in new technologies, in new installations, and in new grids. They are not afraid of the new technology and love it even more if they can make money from it.Recent polls in Taiwan indicate that a growing number of people is also ready to pay higher tariffs for green power as well.
所以德国在绿能方面的努力已经从过去40年来就开始，所以这么长的时间以来， 德国的民众，他们对于绿能、对于再生能源接受度是相当高的。在最近一次的民调当中，就显示有93%的德国民众，他们认为未来绿能的发展很重要，或者是非常重要。那么，也有59%的民众，他们认为，绿能发展可以让他们在接下来有更多的公民参与，在政治上可以有更多的公民参与，甚至连他们的绿能税，也就是他们每单位的电会课大概台币2.4元的这个税金，都让民众觉得可以接受，甚至有些人觉得这个税金还太低，他们愿意付更高。那么在台湾，其实我们可以看到很多的政治人物，他们就是最怕一提到要涨电价，民众就会上街头抗议。为什么在德国我们没有看到类似的情况呢？是因为德国的民众他们理解，他们知道说要有新的科技上的进步是需要钱的，需要花钱投资的。然后他们如果知道这个新的技术将来可以让他们获利的话，他们就会更爱这一项技术。所以这个是台湾可以借鉴，他们也看到在最新的民调当中，台湾的民众也开始越来越有意愿去接受，花付更多的钱来拥抱或者是来接受再生能源。
Once people are in contact or get involved with renewable energies, the approval rate goes up. 69% of the people in Germany living near a wind turbine approve of the use of wind energy, much higher than the national average of 52%. The example of solar parks is even more striking. 90% of the people living near a solar park approve of the use of PV, much higher than the national average of 73%. Once people realize that technology is not harmful, approval rises. This is why governments and the industry must strengthen their efforts to promote and advertise the advantages of renewables. And even more important, the approval rate skyrocket once the local population around renewable energy projects partake in the financial gains. People do accept more renewables if they can make money from them.
好，那么一旦人们开始真的接触到这些再生能源的时候，他们的认同度通常也会提高。所以举德国为例，住在风力发电机附近的民众，他们对于风力发电的认同度是69%，比起全国的平均，也就是52%还要高许多。那么太阳能更是如此，住在太阳能发电机附近或者太阳能面板附近的民众，他们对于太阳能的认同度是90%，相对来说，全国的认同度反而还只有73%。所以一旦民众他们了解到这些再生能源的科技对他们并没有害，他们的接受度就会增加，甚至如果他们发现可以从当中的投资获利的话，那他们就会更爱这些技术。
When I visited Pinghu last year, I noticed the locals turned their onshore turbines into little souvenirs for sale for the tourists. But of course, this is not the money making I'm talking about. I'm talking about community-owned projects.
所以我去年去澎湖玩的时候，我注意到当地人就有把他们的风力发电机做成小小的纪念品，然后卖给大家。但我所谓的获利不是这一种的获利啊，我指的是说民众可以投资，然后从这些计划当中获取他们投资的报酬。
These are German-made
turbines, by the way, on Pinghu. 而且澎湖的风力发电机还是德国制的哦。
In Germany, 50% of the green energy projects are owned and operated by the communities, by the people and farmers, for example, onshore wind turbines, solar projects or biogas plants. In effect, the residents are their own customers by using the heat and energy provided by their own facilities. A key factor in such a project is citizen participation. The planning, funding and constructions require active involvement in the project. Let me quickly give you two examples.
好，在德国有50%的绿能计划都是由当地民众他们自己去参与、自己去营运的。那么这也包括了像是太阳能、生物质能，还有风力发电。所以当地的民众他们不仅是消费使用这些能源，他们自己也是这些能源的主人。那么接下来我会给大家两个很快的例子。
Just one example of the many onshore community projects in Germany. This is in the northeast, outside a small rural village. 31 wind turbines have been installed since the early 90s. Ownership of wind park shares is limited to the local residents only. And by 2014, already 90% of the residents of the village nearby were involved in the project. Overall financing has been based on capital investment of shareholders, as well as on co-funding through commercial credits. The park's production by far exceeds the consumption of the community, and excess energy is sold to the grid. Profits go to the shareholders and are also used for further expansion of renewable energy.
所以这边的这个例子就是德国东北部的一个小镇，可以看到他们这里有风力发电厂。然后，这些风力发电机总共有31台的风力发电机，是从90年代开始建造的。那么现在到了2014年为止，其实已经有90%的当地民众都有参与这一项计划。然后这一些风力发电机，他们的股份跟持有权都是仅限当地的民众可以持有。那现在它的发电量已经完全超过了当地民众他们的用电量，多余的电他们还可以卖回去给全国的电网，然后收到的这个利益呢，就是回到当地民众的口袋里面。
In the city of Freiburg in the south runs a successful community-owned solar project. Freiburg strongly supports the installation of PV and the thermal installation on public buildings, especially schools. Through transparent administrative procedures, citizens are motivated to invest in such projects. With the development of an online tool, citizens are able to easily identify roof spaces available for solar PV and thermal installation, which facilitates the planning process. People can access information on the suitability of certain building structures for PV and on how projects could be realized.
那么这边这个例子只是德国南方的一个城镇，他们只是用了很多的太阳能的技术。那当地的政府甚至还提供一个线上的网站，让民众可以上网去查他们家的网，他们家的屋顶适合安装什么样的太阳能面板，还有什么样的隔热装置，这样子就可以增加他们的接受度，然后也可以增加他们安装的比例。
Germany, we have the south is the sunny part of the country, so we have lots of rooftop PV in southern parts of Germany, and you have villages where basically all the roofs are plastered with PV.
好，所以因为德国南方常常出太阳，所以德国的南部很多人他们的屋顶上面都是有自己装太阳能面板的。
And in the north, next to the North Sea and the Baltic Sea, this is the windy part of the country. So we have onshore wind turbines and lots of offshore wind parks there.
那么相对来说，德国的北部则是比较多风，他们在靠近北海还有波罗的海的地方，风是比较强的，所以他们也有很多陆地上还有离岸的风力发电机。
But most important for building social acceptance in Germany is the dialogue. Dialogue is the only way of reaching public consensus on major infrastructure projects. The new culture of dialogue must take into account the specifics of each case and the interest of all those affected. Building new grids, for example, is the most controversial issue in Germany. Green energy is produced in the south, where the roofs are fitted with PV, and in the north by the wind turbines, far away from the traditional locations of power plants and the customers in the big cities and the industry. The green energy needs to be transported to the customers, which requires heavy expansion. Some 4,500 kilometers of the existing power grid, and this is met by fierce resistance of the local residents. Nobody wants power grids running over their property.
好，所以要建立起大家的接受度，当然对话相当的重要。那要在对话的时候，就是要根据不同的案例，然后也要确保每一个人他们的利益都有被纳入考量。那么现在在德国，他们遇到最大的一个争议就是，传统的发电的地点还有大城市需要用电的地方是不一样的。所以为了要可以配合这样子的一个新的系统，他们必须要拉出很多新的电网，但是没有人会希望这个新的电网电线从他们家门口或者从他们家中间切过去。
This is why since January 2015 the Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs and Energy has been supporting the initiative for a public dialogue on grids and established local citizens bureaus. These citizens bureaus provide information to the public on a case-by-case basis and also feed the public's input back to the authorities. Anybody affected by the expansion of the grid, as well as the general public, is welcome to submit their questions, comments, and queries at any time and receive a reply. In this way, the citizens bureaus will pass on the expertise and the input of locals, which can make all the difference when it comes to resolving issues at local level.
这也是为什么德国政府在2015年一月的时候，开始设立不同的当地的办公室来确保他们可以 一方面宣导政府的理念给当地的民众，可是同时也可以把当地民众他们所有的疑虑还有疑问都收集起来，然后上传到他们的中央政府，而且所有提出疑问的民众他们也都会收到回答。所以借由这样子互动的方式，他们就可以确保说不论是政府还是当地，他们都可以取得一定程度的共识。
Let's look at how to improve renewable energies. In Germany, the energy industry competes for innovations, as innovations yield profit. Nonetheless, the German government is supporting the renewables industry in becoming more efficient for numerous projects in any field of energy production, storage and transport. This happens through the program Research for an Environmentally Sound, Reliable and Affordable Energy Supply. Since July 2017, for example, the German Ministry for Economic Affairs and Energy gives subsidies to research projects on biomass usage. The German government also funds research in offshore wind energy, for example, in the North Sea. Furthermore, a lot of research in power grids for the future is funded by the ministry to upgrade power grids to comply with the unsteadiness of renewables and be more efficient and more smart.
那么当然，再生技术也需要很多的技术改善。那其实业界他们自己本身就会希望创新，因为创新他们才可以有利润。不过呢，德国政府还是另外有提供他们一把助力，所以在不论是生产能源、储存能源还有运送能源上面，德国的政府都有提供辅助。所以举例来说，从2015年的7月开始，德国的经济部就有对于他们生物质能发电的研究计划提供补助。那么另外，他们对于离岸的风力发电，在北海的风力发电也有提供补助。所以除此之外，他们就是希望可以透过这些不同的计划，来确保说他们可以克服风力发电比较不稳的这个困难，然后来确保说风力发电或者是整体的再生能源的发电都可以变得更有效率，而且更有智慧。
Coal and even more gas power plants play an important role in the German climate strategy as bridge technologies. They are necessary for the transition to renewable energy sources and will remain to some extent as a backup in the future. At the same time, they should emit as little CO2 as possible. This is again the huge incentive for the German industry and state-funded research institutions to do research on clean fossil fuel technologies. And in fact, some of the new technologies are so efficient that modernizing old power plants plays an important role in reducing greenhouse gas emissions. German research is aimed at raising the effectiveness of coal power plants up to 50%. Some German companies invest in the construction of those modern power plants and dispose of older, high emission plants. Other research is aimed at designing more flexible power plants, which can easily add huge amounts of power to the system on demand, only minutes after experience shortages of renewable supplies.
好，那除了再生能源之外，德国政府也了解到，他们还是需要仰赖干净的石化能源来作为他们进到下一个阶段之前的一个桥梁。除此之外，他们也认为，就算以后我们仰赖更多的再生能源，我们还是需要有一定程度的干净的石化能源来作为我们的后补，或者是作为我们的备用方案。但是在此同时，我们要确保说这一些石化能源它们会产生的碳排放是越少越好。所以现在有很多发电厂，他们开始去升级他们的发电的设备。所以呢，举例来说，他们就已经要让他们的火力发电的效能提升50%。那么除此之外，他们也要确保他们的火力发电这种传统的能源的发电可以变得更有弹性。所以他们一旦发现再生能源有短缺的时候，他们的能源发电不够的时候，可以随时开启这一些传统的能源，然后来补足他们的不足。
Another important field of research is cleaning the emitted gases from chemical dust and CO2. Old power plants must be upgraded with cleaning technology to reduce emissions. In Germany, there are very strict regulations concerning the emissions of coal power plants. No more than 200 milligrams of sulfur oxides per cubic meter on a single day. And the yearly average must remain below 100 milligrams per cubic meter. This is why many German power plants and industrial plants have emissions flue gas treatment equipment. Carbon capture is also investigated by companies. And this is like answering one of the questions that was posed earlier, what is Germany doing in carbon capture research? So carbon capture is also being investigated in research institutions and university in Germany. Captured CO2 can either be stored underground or be reused. Germany researches the use of CO2 for nutrition of algae and for the production of high-quality plastic. However, carbon capture meets strong reservations in Germany. Storing CO2 underground poses geological issues. And so the public fears similar storage issues as with nuclear waste. Investing in renewables and modernization factories and power plants, that is the industry's job.
好，那另外一个很重要的部分，只是要让我们的传统的火力发电厂变得更干净。所以，德国他们也有很多严格的标准。所以，举例来说，他们的发电厂每天他们的排放里面，每立方公尺的硫氧化物不可以超过200毫克。那么一年以来的平均也是不可以超过100毫克。这也是为什么，德国他们现在在这一方面。有很多新的设备，就是要来协助这些发电厂，可以让他们的排放变得更干净。那除此之外，今天稍早也有提到碳捕捉的这一个议题。现在在德国，他们有很多的政府，很多的企业在研究这一个方案。那么他们也了解到说，这些被捕捉起来的碳可以被储存在地底下，或者是被重新再利用，可能可以拿来当做藻类的养分，也有可能可以拿来做更高品质的。塑胶，可是在此同时，德国民众对于这项技术也是有所保留，因为他们担心，你这个碳放到地底下，在储存的时候可能会造成一些意外，就是有点像是核废料的感觉，所以对于民众来说，他们还是有一些保留的。但不论如何，德国政府他们都认为，在创新还有更新这方面，都是企业他们要去一起负责的。
The next important factor is reducing energy consumption.From 2008 to 2015, primary energy consumption declined by 7.6% to 3,293 petajoules, despite a steadily growing economy, an influx of more than 1.5 million refugees, and some extremely cold winters. While heating demand fell by 12%, transport energy demand has been rising slightly since 2008.Progress in efficiency has been outweighed by a trend to larger cars and an increase in the travel distance. By 2020, primary energy consumption is to fall by 20% compared to 2008. So a decline by 7.6% is not enough to reach that goal. For further energy conservation in the future, the National Action Plan on Energy Efficiency is the driving force. The biggest challenges for energy conservation are in the building and in the transport sector.
那么除了碳排放之外，他们要降低整体的能源的运用，或者是能源的消耗，也是很大的一个目标。从2008年到2015年，他们德国的能源消耗就降低了7.6%。那这一个成就相对来说是还蛮了不起的，因为德国他们的经济还是有不停的在成长，而且刚才有提到，他们已经接纳了来自中东超过100万名的难民，而且他们有这几年还遇到了很寒冷的冬天。不过他们的这个暖气方面的能源消耗还是降低了12%。那么另外在讲到交通方面，其实从2008年开始，他们在交通方面的耗能是稍微增加的。那当然这不是因为他们的效能降低，而是因为他们趋势上来说车子变得越来越大，然后人们开车的距离也变得越来越长。但整体来说，他们的目标是在2020年之前把他们的耗能降低 20%。 那目前降低 7.6% 当然是还是完全不够的，所以接下来他们也有其他的一些法案，像是 NAPE、就是要来在建筑还有交通方面更进一步的降低他们的耗能。
Private households account for about 35% of the total energy consumption in Germany and for about 1/3 of the CO2 emissions. 75% of the total energy consumption of private households is used for heat production. Similar story with Taiwan and the air conditionings. 10% of the private energy consumption is used in form of electricity for lighting, IT, and all kinds of utilities. The potential energy saving in households is huge. Latest research suggests that energy needed for heating would be reduced by 40% until 2030. This is the situation in Germany. Currently, 13.2% of all energy comes from renewables. The target of 14% by 2020 seems within reach. Since 2008, the energy demand for heating came down by a total of 11%. However, given the linear exploration of the development in energy consumption since 2008, it is unlikely that the target of cutting heating energy demands by 20% until 2020 will be reached. But Germany is tackling the issue. The federal government plans Germany's building stock to be virtually climate neutral by 2050. In order to achieve this goal, more of our heating needs to be supplied from renewable energy, and Germany needs to make all the buildings more energy efficient.
好，那德国目前的情况，我们看到他们用电的分布，35%的用电是来自私人的家户，那么他们的碳排放也占了德国大概3%左右。那么家庭他们私人家庭的能源消耗当中有75%其实是来自暖气，所以这个情况跟台湾的冷气是有点类似的。那么另外还有10%就是来自他们的照明或者是其他的家电。那讲到他们的暖气耗了很多的耗能，所以他们德国也有做很多的研究，他们就发现说，在2030年之前，其实他们可以有潜力把他们在暖气上面的耗能减低40%。那目前德国另外的情况则是13.2%的所有能源都是来自再生的能源。那么他们的目标是在2020年之前达到14%，所以目前看起来这个计划、这个目标是可以达到的。不过呢，由于他们的能源消耗目前还是处于一个线性的发展，所以在2020年之前，他们要把暖气方面的耗能降低20%，目前看起来是比较困难一点。但尽管如此，德国政府还是有很多其他方面的作为。所以举例来说，他们就目标在2050年之前要让他们的建材达到所谓的气候中和的状况，也就是说他们的建材不可以影响他们的环境。那这一个做法就是要让他们的暖气的能源来自更多的再生能源，然后也要让他们的建材变得可以更有效率，然后隔热更好。
These are the most prominent improvements in private households. Modernization of water pumps. The installation of modern water pumps can save up to 80% of the electricity needed for the operation, and heating circles could easily be optimized. The German government subsidizes modernization of such technology with up to 30% or up to €25,000. Improving insulation, as about 75% of energy consumption goes into heating the buildings, the insulation of buildings is very important. This goes as much for Taiwan for cooling. The answers are modern ACs as well as well-insulated windows and walls. Yet regulations, awareness and research are not yet very advanced. In 2012, the German government established subsidy programs to modernize the insulation of houses with annually €1.5 billion. It is 50 billion Taiwan dollars. Since 2001, the German Energy Saving Ordinance requires new buildings to comply with energy saving standards, which have become more and more sophisticated in the last 2 years. The German government has the goal to build only climate-neutral buildings after 2020 and, with all the renovations, to reach a completely climate-neutral building stock by 2050. That is extremely ambitious, and in order to reach this goal, approximately 2% of the buildings should be modernized every year. At the moment we are lagging behind, it's only 1.1% of the buildings are getting modernized every year. Therefore, German government is considering further measures to push.
那么此外，在家庭上面有很多的更新，还有很多现代化的作为，可以来帮助他们的能源消耗变得更有效率。所以举例来说，他们在这个水的泵浦上面就有很多新的技术，所以如果他们可以安装这些新的泵浦的话，他们可以省电高达80%，然后在他们的暖气，因为暖气也需要用到水，也会有相当的程度的帮助。那么德国的政府为了要帮助大家更新他们家中的水泵浦，他们也有提供高达30%或者是25,000欧元的辅助。 那么除此之外，在绝缘也就是隔热或者是隔冷的这个技术上面，他们也要相当的去注意，因为我们刚刚有提到 75% 的家庭的能源耗能是来自暖气，所以他们也要确保他们的窗户还有墙都可以隔热。但在这一方面，他们的研究还有大家的认知是好像还是有点不够的，所以在2012年的时候，德国他们的政府也有提供了每年高达15亿欧元，也就是500亿台币的辅助方案，要来推广，然后确保大家可以让他们家中的隔热可以升级。那么除此之外，德国也有很多新的建筑法规，就是因为他们希望说在2020年开始盖的每一栋新的房子都不会影响环境，然后到刚才我提到的2050年之前，就所有的房子都是所谓的环境综合，是不会影响环境的。那为了要达到这一个目标，现在他们是觉得说每一年都要有2%左右的大楼的建筑需要被更新，但目前他们的实际的进度是每一年只有1.1%，所以德国政府现在还在考量有没有新的作为可以再进一步的加快这个脚步。
Let's now look at the second largest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions in Germany, the transport sector. Taking all modes of transport together, final energy consumption in the transport sector has been rising in the last years. This is everything else but promising. If Germany is to attain the target of cutting energy consumption by 10% over the 2005 figures, much stronger efforts are required. Therefore, the German government measures in the transport sector include promoting and pushing e-mobility, more sophisticated recharging infrastructure for electric vehicles at home, on the road, at the workplace and at shopping sites, more climate-friendly approach to freight transport, upgrading the railway infrastructure, boosting local public transport, promoting and support of bicycle and pedestrian traffic and car sharing.
那么除了居家的用电耗能之外，第二大的耗能来源就是交通运输，所以德国在这方面也有相当程度的作为。可是我们也有讲到，在过去几年来，其实他们交通部门交通方面的耗能是不停的在上升的。所以如果德国他们真的想要在接下来几年内达到2005年以来降低10%的整体耗能的这个目标的话，他们在交通运输这一方面还要有相当大的努力。所以他们的策略就是列出了现在投影片上面写的这些，那时间关系我就不一个一个念了，大家看投影片就可以了。
The plan to get 1 million electric vehicles on the road by 2020 is seriously lagging behind. As of end of last year, there were only about 75,000 electric vehicles on the German roads. That is less than 1% of all our cars. In order to increase the number of electric vehicles, the German government has decided to subsidize the purchase of electric cars with 4,000 euros and hybrid cars with 3,000 euros. But people are still reluctant. The German government will take additional measures to push e-cars, which is perceived as inconvenient. The German Bundesrat, this is our upper house, recently called for legislature that after 2030, all new cars registered in Germany have to be e-cars. This is a big issue. German people love their cars, and our huge car manufacturing industry is heavily based on combustion engines. In the meantime, the charging infrastructure is being upgraded. Subsidies are provided for local charging points, that is another incentive for the industry. And most important, as e-cars will become mandatory sooner or later, the industry needs to develop e-transport that is affordable, with a big range and easy charging.
所以德国他们计划要在2020年之前让100万台电动车上路，可是目前这个目标是严重的落后，因为在2016年12月为止，目前德国的路上只有75,000台，也就是不到1%的所有的车子是电动车。所以为了要确保更多的人会开电动车，德国的政府他们也有很多的补助方案。所以如果你要买电动车的话，他们会有4,000欧元的补助，如果要买油电混合车就是有3,000欧元的补助。但尽管如此，大部分的人还是觉得油电混合车或者是电动车很不方便。所以为了要突破这一点，德国的国会他们最近又通过了一条法案，或者是说他们要提倡一个法案，也就是说在2030年开始，所有的新车，德国的新车都必须是电动车。那这对德国来说是一个很大的冲击，因为德国人就是喜欢他们的 就是马力很大 的一般的车子嘛。好，所以在此同时，当然我们要让大家改变他们的使用习惯，这个充电站还有充电这些基础设施也必须要被进一步的提升。所以我们现在要理解到一点是，迟早所有路上的车子都要变成电动车。好，所以现在他们就要开始拥抱这个改变。
However, some modes of transport are likely to run on combustion engines for the near future, trucks and ships which carry large freight. Here, German strategy is to replace conventional fossil fuels with a mixture of LNG and biomethanol made from renewable agricultural products. LNG is more climate friendly than diesel fuel. Mixed with bioethanol, the greenhouse gas emissions can be reduced by up to 93%.Furthermore, the combustion of LNG does not generate particles and sulfur oxides. The German government supports pilot projects with LNG fuel. By 2020, the German government wants 4% of the transport powered by LNG. Germany also assists the European Union to establish guidelines to equip all the major trucking routes in the European Union with LNG fuel stations every 400 kilometers.
那么当然，在真的达成所有的车子都是电动车的目标之前，我们还是需要一些其他的化石燃料。所以举例来说，像是卡车或者是货轮这种比较需要运输重量的东西，这种重量的运输方式，他们就还是可能会需要仰赖传统的石化燃料。可是不是石油，而是可以用天然气或者是生物乙醇这些不会排放出比较有污染的，像是。硫氧化合物这样子的物质的燃料来源，所以如果他们可以使用生化燃料或者是天然气的话，他们就可以把温室气体的排放降低93%。那德国政府他们也有其他的一些计划，所以举例来说，在2020年之前，他们希望所有他们的交通工具的4%是由这些天然气或者是生化燃料来提供动能。那除此之外，德国政府也有帮助欧盟政府来提供一些像是他们希望接下来在主要的卡车会经过的这个路线当中，每400公里就要有这一个天然气或者是生化燃料的加油站。
Look at the impact on the economy. Going green is actually a big advantage. So far, more than 400,000 new jobs have been created in the renewable energy sector, most of them in wind power. And this does not only apply to Germany. Studies suggest that on global average in the wind energy sector, for every new megawatt of capacity installed in the country per year, 14 persons are employed in that year in manufacturing,component supply, wind farm development, construction, transportation, etc. And later on, still 0.33 persons per year per megawatt of installed capacity are needing for operations and maintenance work of existing wind farms.
那结论来说，其实我们使用绿能对经济也会有很大的帮助。目前为止，德国他们因为绿能已经创造了40万份的工作机会，尤其是在风力发电这一方面。但这其实不是只有德国而已，全世界都可以是如此。他们的研究就有显示，在全球来看，接下来如果风力发电他们的产能每增加100万瓦，他们就可以创造14个新的工作机会。那除了安装之外，接下来他们在维修还有营运上面也是可以持续的创造新的工作机会。
Putting aside figures and targets, and this is actually my favorite numbers down there, back in 1991, approximately 0.59 million tons of CO2 were emitted for each billion euro of GDP. In 2014, for every billion euro of GDP, only 0.33 million tons of CO2 were emitted, a decline of around 43%. So that shows, despite rising economic output,Germany is emitting less and less greenhouse gases. The reduction of greenhouse gas emission may as well be a source of income for the industry and economic growth. And this is an important message to the Taiwanese industry. Decarbonization doesn't mean deindustrialization, but it means modernization.
那么接下来这些数字也可以看到，在1991年的时候， 每10亿欧元的 GDP 就会产生59万吨的二氧化碳。可是到了2014年的时候，这个数字降低到了33万吨，总共减少43%。也就是说，虽然经济有持续的在成长，可是德国他们的二氧化碳排放却是越来越少。这也就表示说，其实我们在环保跟经济上是不一定要舍弃其中一者，我们是可以两者并行的。甚至说，我们可以给台湾的参考的一个讯息，就是说我们在考量到去碳的时候，不要觉得它是表示去工业化，它其实是现代化的一个代表。
Germany's experiences with greenhouse gas reduction proves, with government's regulation and incentives, it is possible to reach reduction targets. The industry profits from innovation and new technologies. Greenhouse gas emission reduction has no negative impact on the economy. Green energy creates new jobs. To fight climate change, we have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Taiwan is very committed to go green and reduce emissions, but still standing at the starting line. So there is no time to waste. Or in the words of the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, there is no plan B, and then, as there is no planet B.
好，所以在德国我们可以给大家分享的经验就是下面几点，政府的规定跟刺激方案就可以帮助大家达到我们减碳目标，而且工业他们也可以从创新当中获利。而且我们这一些再生能源创新对经济来说是没有造成负面影响的，甚至还会产生新的职缺，带来新的经济发展。所以我们在对抗全球暖化的时候，我们就一定要减少温室气体的排放。台湾对于这一方面当然有相当大的决心，可是我们好像还是有点站在起跑点，没有真的踏出第一步，所以我们现在没有时间可以浪费了。套一句之前联合国秘书长潘基文所说的，我们没有第二颗地球，所以我们没有第二个计划，我们现在这个计划就一定要赶快采取开始实行。谢谢大家。
谢谢大家。
德国的副大使给我们非常多的这个进去，大家可以看到，其实德国人在整个能源转型，他们提出的目标、策略、政策，还有刚刚讲的社会的接受度、价值的创造，还有实验性的研发，还有最后他提到的这个经济发展跟排碳是一定这个新的经济发展趋势，我想这些都是我们台湾可以直接学习的。其实德国在1990年代的时候，他们的经济的 GDP 所得是往上，但是排碳已经开始频繁甚至下降。那 UK 也是这样的一个情况。那我想我们因为时间关系，我们还是有半小时，我尽量控制在12点半。我取得那个副代表的这个同意，我们来跟大家做一个交流跟讨论。因为刚刚这样走，我们现在就是请那个马迪哲老师来上台来代答。如果有什么样政府疑难杂症的问题，我想我们李老师现在在能源减碳办公室，他可以来帮忙回答。好，那我们接下来就open to the floor， 我们就开放几个，我们先问几个题目一起回答，然后再问。那请大家请大家先自我简单介绍，那请大家拜托就是简短一点，2分钟好不好？每一个人都要2分钟。